we're going to jump into a new series today. We just finished a series last Sunday. For the whole month of September, we did a series called Bearing Fruit. And if you missed that, please jump online, catch up with us. It was a ton of fun over the last month talking about bearing fruit. And today is kind of like part two, a continuation of that series. And John 15, as we read every Sunday for 4 weeks, there's this phrase in there that says, if you bear fruit, this will be for my Father's glory, comma, and this is how they will know you are one of my disciples. Disciples is that word that Jesus used. And so today, we're going to talk about what does it mean to be a disciple. Okay, we're bearing fruit. That makes us become a disciple. What does that mean to be a disciple? So today, we're starting a new series for the month of October called The Cost of Discipleship. The Cost of Discipleship. Shout out to Derek Chupanheifer, kind of made this phrase or this idea about following Jesus, discipleship, the cost therein, and living a life under Jesus. So today, we're going to borrow that phrase and do a series called The Cost of Discipleship. The Cost of Discipleship. Turn with me to the book of Luke today. Book of Luke, chapter 9. If you have a Bible, go ahead and grab it with us. YouVersion, phone, whatever you're going to read. Luke, chapter 9, quotes on the screen for you. Also, there's a Bible there right in front of you. If you don't have one or don't own one, want to read along with us, grab that one. You can read with us from Luke, chapter 9. If you're newer to the Bible, Luke is to the right. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the first four books of the Bible in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, right there, chapter 9, we're going to read. And if you are newer to Jesus and you've never read the Bible or maybe perused it a bit, you'll find out even there's some wild stuff in the Old Testament, for sure. But in the New Testament even, you'll read these stories of Jesus and he'll say stuff. And usually you should think this after some of these stories of Jesus, you'll read it and be like, what? Jesus did not mean that. There's no way he said that. There's a couple stories and interactions that Jesus had that are wild, that are just different, hard to understand, and a bit awkward and a bit mean and harsh, and we just kind of skip over them. Today, we're going to read one of these texts, one of these stories. You'll read it and you'll see, like, there's no way Jesus meant that. I think they misunderstood. It's a difficult text to process together. So Luke chapter 9, Luke chapter 9, verses 57 to 62. Luke chapter 9, verse 57 to 62 says this, as they, being Jesus and his disciples, as they're walking along, someone came up to Jesus and said, I will follow you, Jesus, wherever you go, I want to follow you. And Jesus replied, foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Could you imagine coming up for prayer after service and be like, hey, like, Jacqueline, I want prayer. She goes, foxes have dens. Birds have nests. Like, what a response. Foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Another person came up and said, and Jesus said, come and follow me. The man agreed. And he said, but first, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. Seems like a reasonable response. Look at Jesus' answer. But Jesus told him, no, let the spiritually dead bury their own. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Or other translations say, your duty is to follow me right now and preach about the kingdom. Another said, yes, Lord, I will follow you also. But first, let me go say goodbye to my family. Reasonable response. But Jesus told him, no. Anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Jesus, are you okay? Didn't get your sleep last night, didn't get your cup of coffee. Like, what's going on here? Like, Jesus, I want to follow you. Foxes have dens. Next person, I want to follow you. Can I go bury my dad? No, follow me right now. Are you anti-family? Next person, I want to follow you. Can I just go say goodbye? No, follow me right now. What is Jesus saying? We're going to unpack this together today, and as we kick off this series, I do forewarn you. Today is going to be a bit heavier. I did not mean it to be this way, but last service, I've been through these talks for like 6 months. I hope you know this. I don't just like randomly preach things up here. Like I spend months and months and months thinking and writing and praying. So this has been like 6 months spinning in my head for a bit. And so today's going to be a bit heavy. Stay with me. Also, if you are brand new today, and this is your first time ever in church, today's going to be a lot, number one. Number two, I also think it might be a very, very, very good day for you to ask the question, do I really want this? To be really honest. Today, my title is going to give it away. I want to talk about the lie of modern Christianity. Yeah. Buckle up. The lie of modern Christianity. Let's pray. God, I thank you for today. I thank you for this amazing bizarre text that we could easily just read by and think that you're being mean and harsh and unkind and non-pastoral, very dismissive. But Jesus, I pray as we embark on this text today, would you illuminate it? Would you reveal it to us on what you are speaking, what you are saying in this context? Not in our American Western mind, but in what you were saying, what you meant, what those phrases meant to those people. Would you open our eyes today to see your word? Would you open our heart today to receive it? God, we thank you for this series that we're about to embark on, the cost of discipleship, that we want to become disciples. I pray for every person in the sound of my voice that we would leave deeply changed and different from the inside out today. In your mighty, mighty name I pray. And everyone said?
Amen.
There's a man back in 1859, a while ago, called Charles Blunden. If you want to write that down, Charles Blunden was a man who became a professional tightrope walker. Did it at fairs and games and, you know, festivals around. He became famous for his distance and his height and his ability to walk on these very, very tight ropes. So he moved to America, and his goal was to walk across Niagara Falls. He went a tightrope. No one's ever done it that height, that distant. He went a tightrope across Niagara Falls. So he advertises it, tells people word of mouth, right, in the newspapers and telling, walking through the streets. And, you know, obviously it was 1859, no cell phones, no internet, right? So, like, word of mouth, going street by street, telling people. So he gets to Niagara Falls, a couple thousand people are there. He gets the rope across, and he, for the first man ever, walks across the tightrope Niagara Falls. People are screaming. He walks all the way back, does it again. He says, "Who believes I can do it again, even harder?" Another bring something with me, and they all scream. So he does it on stilts. No net, nothing. On stilts, walks across the tightrope on Niagara Falls, there and back. Now the crowd's growing. Now there's thousands and thousands. Word of mouth, people are going to their homes, telling streets, people, like, the word is moving. Now thousands are gathering. He says, "Who believes I can do it again?" And this one man in the front is, like, screaming, like, I believe. And then he goes, "Who believes I can stop in the middle and sit down on the rope?" The crowd screams. So the man, Charles Blunden, he goes to the middle of the rope. He sits down on it and has an egg in his pocket and a plate. And he scrambles himself an egg in the middle of the tightrope, eats it, and then gets up, walks back, and comes over. Now the crowd is losing it. They're like, "What else can I do?" And a man says, take a wheelbarrow over. So he's walking out to hold this wheelbarrow. So the man gets on the other side in front of tens of thousands of people. He starts asking the crowd, "Who believes?" And the crowd's like, we believe. Right, like they're screaming for this guy. He's like, "Who believes I can take the wheelbarrow across?" And they're all like, "We believe." He goes to this man right in the front. "Do you believe it?" He's like, "I do." He's like, "Do you believe it?" And they're like, they're going back and forth. And he's like, "I believe in you." And he's like, "Then get in the wheelbarrow. Join me and get in the wheelbarrow." Man goes, "Mm-mm. I ain't going." And now the crowd is like, "Do it." And then it's like, "No." And he's like, "You said." It's like, "Do you believe?" "Yes." "Get in." "No." And the crowd's like, it's this whole thing's going. And the moral of the story goes, like, you can shout "you believe" all you want until you're asked to get in the wheelbarrow. I'd like to submit to many of us in the room today, when it comes to our relationship with Jesus, we've been shouting "I believe" for a long time. Jesus, "Do you believe me? I believe." And he's like, "Why don't you get in the wheelbarrow and come with me?" Mm-mm. I don't believe that much. Why? Because the man, the story goes, you can stand on the shore, you can stand on the edge and tell Jesus all you want, "I believe in you. I believe in you." And Jesus is like, "Come with me. Get in the wheelbarrow and come." I don't know about that. And what, for many of us, Jesus has asked us to follow him. We're like, "I believe in you." But when it comes to actually acting on your word or following what you believe, the wheelbarrow is not worth it. What's amazing about Jesus is there is many, many stories in the Bible, especially in the Gospels, the four Gospels, many stories that Jesus comes by these people in their booths and their boats and the shores and their homes and the marketplace and church and synagogues and Pharisees, like all these interactions Jesus has. And many, many times Jesus goes, "Hey, follow me. You come with me. You come with me. You follow me. You come with me." And most people go, "I'm in." And they would leave everything, leave nets and homes and families and jobs and relationships and cities, and they would all follow Jesus. But there's another group of people, many stories. This is not the only one we read today. The rich young ruler comes to Jesus, says, "I want to follow you." And he says, "Well, go sell everything." He's like, "I'm super rich. I don't want to do that." And he leaves. These three men leave. There's a story in John 6 where Jesus gets done preaching. And the Bible says this. The Bible says specifically when he gets done preaching, many disciples said to themselves, this is too hard to understand, and they walked away. It does not say the crowds walked away. It says many disciples said, this is too hard. We will walk away. There's many other stories. There's some people when Jesus came by and said, follow me, they go, we're in. But this group of people that decided not to. Physical, literal Jesus saying, you want to come with me? Like, I do. This is what's going to happen if you follow me. And they go, never mind. Why? Because the cost was too high. They did not believe that following Jesus was worth the cost it was going to take to follow him. In other words, many people were shouting, I believe. But when Jesus invited them into the wheelbarrow, they go, no, thank you. No, thank you. Because this is what tends to happen. I think for many people, even like me on a stage, we walk up here and we preach about everything that you're going to gain if you follow Jesus. I just think we have been lying to people. Not we, other churches. Other churches in the city. Not me. But I think sometimes preachers only ever tell you what you're going to gain, not what you're going to lose. That's why I think for many people in the room today, you're here with your girlfriend or your neighbor, and you're like, I think church is cool. I'm going to follow Jesus. You're going to find out today what it's going to mean. Because I think, well, you're going to gain. And many of those sermons are true. You're going to gain some stuff. But friend, I've come to tell you the truth, that if you decide to follow Jesus, it's going to cost you some stuff. It's going to cost you some stuff. Now, this is the phrase that's been in my mind for some time. Now, stay with me. Buckle up. This is the question I'm asking myself, and I'm going to ask you as our church. Are you becoming a modern Christian or an ancient disciple? Are you becoming a modern Christian or an ancient disciple? Now, your question is, well, how would I know? I'll break it down for you. First, a modern Christian is those that believe in God, know who he is, even believe who he is, but don't live like Jesus, act like Jesus, talk like Jesus, don't date like Jesus, marry like Jesus. They do not like church, don't go to church, don't read the Bible, don't pray, have no interest in becoming like Jesus. They simply have a higher intellect of acknowledge that God's real. But church is not there, church is not prevalent, the holiness is not prevalent, change is not prevalent, Bible, prayer, tithing, reading, none of it. None of the gospel's there, none of the New Testament's there. The only thing that reigns, or only thing that is real, is that they believe in God. Now, this is gonna ruffle some feathers. It's in this room and all the overflows. If that's our definition of Christianity, the devil's a Christian. The devil believes in God. He knows him very well. The devil also believes in who God is. He knows he's all powerful. That's why demons, every time Jesus came around, don't please, they bowed. Even demons know who that name is. So if our definition of Christian is to simply believe God's real, all of hell is Christian then. Every demon in hell is a Christian then. Now, the only problem with that definition is not in the Bible. That's not the term Christian in the Bible. We are not called to become modern Christians. We are called to become disciples. And that's a big difference. You know, that was our name, right? Well, long before we were ever called Christians, we were called disciples. But my fear is for not us in this room, other churches, we are all deeply committed in this room. But the American church, we are more concerned with becoming a modern Christian because it costs us nothing. Then we are becoming a disciple. Look what Bonhoeffer says in his amazing book around this idea. It says, commitment, look at this, a commitment to an idea about Christ, a doctrinal system, a general religious recognition does not require discipleship. Christianity without following the living Jesus Christ remains a Christianity without discipleship. And a Christianity without discipleship is always a Christianity without Jesus. I want you to see that first sentence. I want you to cue into that first sentence. Commitment to an idea about Christ or some system or general religious recognition doesn't cost you anything and does not require discipleship. No wonder we're more willing to become a modern Christian up here because it costs us nothing out here. I can aspire to an idea, to a name, to a religion, to a religious system, to recognition that God's real. No wonder we're okay with the modern idea. I just have to commit. my mind to an idea, because committing my thoughts to an idea does not cost me anything. Becoming a disciple costs us something. And the reality is, people in this room and people around this earth, we simply just want Jesus without the cost. We want Jesus without the discipleship. Look at what Dallas Willard says. He says, the greatest thing facing the world today is whether those who profess to be Christian will ever become a disciple. One of the greatest things facing us is those who profess to be Christian, will they ever become a disciple? I don't know if I've said this before, but it's been my mind before. There's many people in this room that were raised Catholic. And one thing about Catholicism, or those who were raised Catholic, you know this in language, even in our question with these, oh, like, were you raised Catholic? Yes. Are you a practicing Catholic? Super interesting. I have friends in this room that were raised Jewish, like for real Jewish. And you meet somebody who was raised Jewish, are you a practicing Jew? Why do we use that word practicing before their term? Because you and I know, even in our language and our relationship with those people, there's a big difference between a cultural Jew and a practicing Jew. There's a big difference between a cultural Catholic. I was raised Catholic and went to Mass when I was a child, but I'm not a practicing Catholic. We know there's a big difference between a cultural Catholic and a practicing Catholic. I would like to submit to you and I today, it might be time to start using the term, are you a practicing Christian? Are you a Christian? Oh yeah, my mom went to church when I was a kid. That's what Christian is now? Oh, are you a Christian? Oh yeah, my grandma took me to church when I was a little kid and read me the Bible at night. Do you follow Jesus? Oh no, 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 but I'm a Christian. What do you mean? I think it's now the same. Christianity has become another cultural ideal that we aspire to because we're not Buddhists, we're not Catholic. I guess I'm a Christian. What does that mean? Oh, you believe in God? I think it might be time to start asking, are you a following Jesus person? Are you becoming a disciple of Jesus? Because our goal today, and I know this is very jarring, by the way, sermons like this is not how you grow churches. This is how you shrink churches. But I also say this is how you actually grow people. So today is not the most like, we're gonna grow because of this. And all the people clapping in the front three rows. The back row is like, Modern Christianity sounds pretty good. It does. And it's a lie. It does sound good, but it's a lie. Let us go back to Luke 9. I want to unpack these three men, these three stories, these three responses, and I'm just going to be the honest guy on stage. Tell you the truth. I'll lie to you next Sunday, but today I will tell you the truth on what it's going to cost you. On what it's going to cost you. Look at Luke 9. It says, as they were walking, someone came up to Jesus. Look at, he comes up to Jesus and says, I will follow you wherever. Whoa, how much faith. And Jesus replies, foxes have dens. Birds have nests, and the Son of Man no place to lay his head. The next man comes up and he says, you follow me. And the man agreed and he said, Lord, first let me return to my father and bury him. The next person comes and says, do you want to follow me? He says, Lord, I will follow you, but first let me go say goodbye to my family. Do you see what these three men say? They all call him Lord. They don't call him good teacher. They don't call him prophet. They don't call him rabbi. They call him Lord. And yet, as all three call him Lord, none of them follow him. Write this down. Calling him Lord is not the same as making him Lord. Calling him Lord is not the same as making him Lord. Why? Because calling him Lord costs you nothing. Making him Lord costs you everything. Lord is a specific term, friend. It's not good man, moralist, revolutionist. Like he's not, they use the term Lord. I believe in who you are. You are my Lord. Follow me. I don't want to, I'm not going to leave my family. I'm not going to bury my father. I'm not going to say goodbye. Why? Because calling him Lord is one thing. Making him Lord is another. And Jesus does not just want you to call him Lord. He wants you to make him Lord. But why don't we? Why don't we make him Lord? It's because it's going to cost us some stuff. Here's the three things it's going to cost you. Stay with me. What's back to the first response? He's walking along and the man comes up and says, I want to follow you. And Jesus says, okay. Foxes have dens. Birds have nests. But the Son of Man will have no place to lay his head. The first thing that's going to happen when you start following Jesus is, write this down. It's going to, the cost of broken expectations. What's it going to cost me if I start following Jesus? Great question, friend. It's going to cost you your expectations. Could you imagine this man, he walks up to Jesus. He walks up to Jesus, says, I want to follow you. I'm in. Lord, I'm in. Jesus, you want to follow me? Come on. Could you imagine? They start following. They start walking. The man's like, man, I'm going to start following Jesus. I'm going to get a bigger house. That marriage is going to be fixed. I'm going to get out of poverty. I'm going to get healed. And we put our list of expectations on Jesus' name. And we start following for a bit. And then we start noticing the list that we gave Jesus isn't really being fulfilled. And then we start saying stuff like, why are you letting me down? I thought if I followed you, I'd get out of poverty.
When did he say that?
I thought if I followed you, my marriage would be fixed. When did he say that? It's almost like if we don't get our list from him, he's not worth it. So it's almost like we are more so pursuing lists through Jesus, not for Jesus. Oh, this person will give me my list? Then I choose him. Well, what happens when your expectations don't start happening? And one of the major things that you're going to have to figure out when it comes to following Jesus is you're going to realize really quick, it's going to cost you some broken expectations. Friends, I've been doing this for a while, and I've had that phrase said to me, texted me, DM'd, tears, ugly snot, I mean, ugly girl cry. It's this phrase, he let me down. God let me down. Did he let you down, or did your ideals let you down? Did God let you down, or did your unset expectations of him let you down? And I've come to ask you today, what happens if your list doesn't work? Your list of expectations. This is crazy. What happens if the only thing you get from the list is him? Is he still worth it? We all want to shout yes. But some of you have some stuff on some lists. And you're like, but if this doesn't happen, I don't know, man. One of the things that following Jesus is going to cost you is broken expectations. You know that when we go to heaven, right? That like there's no pain, no sin. He wipes every tear. Like we're going home as it should be. It feels like Earth has become a really long vacation that's gone wrong. So we should have been home. You've been on vacation. I should have went home 2 days ago. Like when you planned it was like a 10-day vacation, but you thought 14 days would be fun. And then like day 13, you're like, we made a mistake. We should have went home in the 10-day. That's what Earth has become. We're like, this is not what it should be. We're going home. And at home, there's no sin, no error, no cancer, nothing. Which means Earth is the only place you can choose to worship him through disappointment. You can't worship God in heaven through disappointment because there'll be none. You can't worship God in heaven through cancer because there'll be none. You can't worship in heaven through loss because there'll be none. Earth is the only chance you will ever get where you get to choose through your disappointment, is he still worthy of my worship? That's why I know a lot of you in this room, not everyone, so I'm sorry if I haven't learned your name yet, but I know a lot of you in this room, and I know the pain that sits in this room. And you know what gets me is not like how great Emmanuel's voice is. I don't care. I don't care how much I love this song. I don't care how good our band is, though they are the freaking best. I don't care. When I look around and I see people who I know are going through hell, because they're choosing, though I felt like you let me down, you are still worthy. Though I just lost so much I will still lift my eyes. I will still lift my hands. Why? Because you are more important than my broken expectations. I want to follow you. You sure? Well, yeah, we're going to be super comfortable in the big house, right? No, we're going to feel homeless a lot of the time. You ever feel like following Jesus is just like you're a nomad? You're not from Portland, you're from LA, but LA's not home anymore either. But Portland hasn't become yet either. And these friends are like family, but they're not your family. And your family more seems like friends now. And you feel in this weird middle. Where am I? Following Jesus? And sometimes following Jesus feels homeless. Feels distant. But foxes have dens. We don't. Birds have nests. No, there's going to be some days where you have no place to lay your head. That speaks to literal life, by the way. Like back then, they would become homeless because of following Jesus. That also means there's just no place I can find rest to lay my head. So what I have to keep doing? Walking with him. The first thing it's going to cost you is broken expectations. And many of which the expectations you don't understand. Why? Because if God was small enough to understand, he wouldn't be big enough to worship. If God was small enough for your puny little mind, I know you have double degrees, but you have a puny little mind, our finite mind compared to God. We can't wrap our mind around why did you not and why did you. But if God was always small enough to understand, he would not be big enough to worship. You're going to have to sift through the cost of broken expectations. The second, let's keep going. The next response, another man comes and says, I will follow you. Jesus, come and follow me. And the man agreed. Oh, I will follow you. I agree. But then he said, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. Seems reasonable. Kind of a big deal. Jesus is pro-family. Jesus is pro-marriage, right? Like he's pro-honoring. It's one of the Ten Commandments, honor father and mother. But what does Jesus say? No. Let the spiritually dead bury their own. Are you okay, Jesus? What, are you hungry? Like, talk about hangry. Let the spiritually dead bury their own. Your duty is to go right now. That's the term. Follow me right now. And go preach the kingdom. Go preach the good news. Now, there's huge arguments in this text. And I'll tell you both. But they both argue each side, but they all land in one place. So there's one side of the argument that people believe that the man's father's not yet dead. Jesus, the man's not saying, my father's dying right now. Can I go bury him like tomorrow as he dies? Then I'll come. Many theologians and Jewish historians about this text in the Greek language, they would believe the man's father's not yet dead. They actually believe the man's father's quite young. But they believe that this man in the text is the oldest brother of the family. And if you read Jewish literature, one of the major laws and rules of the oldest brother of the home is they could not leave the home ever for work or life or marriage, anything, until their father died. And it was on the oldest brother to bury their father. That was a law, a big deal to Jewish culture. The oldest brother must stay home until the father dies and he must bury them. So what's happening, many argue in this story, is the man is saying, when my dad dies, I'll come find you. I got to go home. I have to do my duty. I'm staying here till my dad dies. I'll come find you later. The other side of the argument, the Greek word, let me go bury my father, is a very unique word. And in Jewish literature and Jewish culture, when a father died, they would bury him in like the backyard, essentially. They would mourn for 7 days and then go back to their life. And they'd let the father be there for 1 year as their body decomposed, once all the skin and super gross, but once it was just bones, they would dig up the bones, put the bones in a box, and bury it underneath their house so the presence of the father was still always there. So the other side of the argument is this: the father's been dead for a year, and the man's saying, no, I need to go get my father's bones first. But he's been dead for a year. This is the big argument, but they both land in. There's no way this text is saying, my father's dying tomorrow. Can I go bury him? Jesus is like, no. Because that goes contrary to his life. He would go say bye to people before they died all the time. So Jesus would be split between his ways, which is heresy. Jesus was always consistent. Jesus would go say bye to people before they died. So this was not happening. What everyone agrees on, both sides of the argument, what they both agree on is the man is literally saying, can I follow you tomorrow? That's what he's saying. You and I do the same, don't we? Jesus, after senior year of college, I'm in. Jesus, once we get married and get settled, we'll attend church more consistently. Jesus, once we have some kids and get our finances, we'll serve after that. We always give Jesus tomorrow because it's not real. Tomorrow's easy to give away. Jesus, next week, man, it's all yours. I got today, though. Why? Because today is the only thing that costs you. Tomorrow costs you nothing. Giving Jesus your senior year of college while you're a freshman costs you nothing. You know what costs you? Jesus, I give you right now. So the second thing, number one, it's going to cost you broken expectations. Number two, it's going to cost you reordering priorities. Reordered priorities. Well, Jesus, I'm going to follow you, but I got to graduate first. Jesus, we will follow you, but let's have a few kids first. Jesus, I will tithe, but let me make more money first. Jesus, I will serve, but let me get some more time in my day first. Jesus, I will make church more consistent. Let me travel less. We always push Jesus off to tomorrow. But friend, one thing you better realize if you start following Jesus, he's going to reorder priorities. He's going to reorder priorities. Look at this quote by Bonhoeffer again. Staying in the old life and following Jesus mutually exclude each other. Staying in your old life, your old ways, your old relationships, your old way of thinking, staying in your old life and following Jesus mutually exclude each other. He reorders priorities. How many times in your life have you told Jesus, yeah, I'm in, but first let me. No, Jesus, I will follow, but first. I will tithe, but first. I will serve, but first. I will be more consistent, but first. I will read, I will pray. Jesus, look at the man. He comes to Jesus, I'm in. Jesus, I'm in. I choose to follow you, but first let me. How many times in our prayers and our walks and our time with God, we go, I will, but first. What we're telling Jesus is you're not number one. So but he's top three, that's pretty good. He's higher than this. He's higher than that. Here's the thing, if you are considering following Jesus, he will be nothing but first. He will be first. And when you make him first, it starts reprioritizing everything else. There's people in the room today. You need to stop giving Jesus your tomorrow. And stop pushing him off, saying, oh yeah, one day. No, he's saying right now, today, follow me. But if I follow you today, my plan changes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but if I follow him to Portland, my dream changes. Mm-hmm. But if I stay in Portland and not go back to LA, everything changes. Yep. Is it worth it? Is he worth the cost of not just broken expectations? Is he worth the reprioritization of your life? He will reprioritize. He will sift the order. And this is what's hard for me, even theologically, even pastorally. This is hard for me to say, but I have to because it's in the Bible. Sometimes me and AJ will go back and forth. He's like, you have to say that. I'm like, I don't want to. He's like, you have to. I'm like, why? He's like, it's in the Bible. I'm like, well, can I read like the Message version instead and have it not be in there? The rich young ruler, he walks away. These three men walk away. The crowd in John 6 walk away. There's two other stories when Jesus says to count the cost, they all walk away. There's at least seven. All seven walk away. You know what's crazy to me? Jesus didn't chase one of them down. He let them all walk away. Not one time did these three men go, well, okay, I'm not going to follow you. Okay, yeah, you can say bye for one day. That's it. That's all I'll give you. Jesus never chased someone down that said, I want to follow you, and Jesus gave them the price, and they walked away. Jesus never, okay, I'll change it for you. I need you really bad. I'll change the standard for you because I need you that bad. No, please. Okay, you say bye for one day, I'll give you one day. Is that good enough? Jesus never chased them down. He let every one of them walk away. All of them. You know why? Because Jesus would rather lose a follower than lower standards. And that's hard for me. Because people email me, I'm leaving the church. Why? Well, if you do this, I'll stay. And my human side goes, oh, I'll change, please stay. The other side of me is like, I don't care. I can't change for everyone. I can't chase every person down. If Rose is for you, Rose is for you. If it's not, God bless. There's a bunch of amazing churches, like, by no problem. But there's something in us, right? When someone says they're leaving, they go get them. And Jesus is like, that's cool. You can walk.
You're gonna let me walk away?
Mm-hmm. You don't want me? Oh, no, I do. Well, do this. No, I'm not gonna do that. Okay, then you don't have to follow. He draws a line in the sand. He says, if you don't follow me, this is what it is. This is the price. A couple years ago, I was in Australia, I think. Canada or Australia, some place not America. And Julia wasn't with me. I don't know where I was. And there was a Louis Vuitton store there. And, you know, American money in Canada and Australian use Commonwealth nations goes way farther. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to go in this Louis Vuitton store and check the clearance section and find Julia some cheap purse, you know? And I'm going to be the best husband ever. But I'm going to tell her it was like $5,000, but it was like $200 because of the exchange. So like, I'm going to be the best ever. So I'm going through this Louis Vuitton store, and this woman comes up to me. She's like, can I help you? I was like, yeah, ma'am, I'm just looking for the clearance section. And she goes, oh, honey. This is real. Oh, honey. She looks straight at me and goes, it's Louis Vuitton. I was like, I know that. Where's the clearance section? And she goes, oh, Louis Vuitton never goes on sale. There is no such thing as clearance section. I was like, what? She's like, it's always worth the full price, and walks off. Obviously figuring out I can't afford full price. It's just the most snooty lady in the world. I would submit to us, many of you have come into God's house looking for the clearance section. And Jesus says back, in a much nicer way, there's no clearance section. It's always full price. Because I think many Christians in America are just trying to find the cheapest way in. What's the lowest threshold I can do to not go to the pit? If that's real, I don't want to go. Jesus seems better than the other option. So what is the least amount of work I have to do to get in? And if you would come in, there is no clearance section, there is no half off, there's no buy one, get one. It costs what it costs. And it costs everything. And one of the major things it's gonna cost you is broken expectations and your reordering of priorities. The last, and it's the hardest. Another comes and says, Lord, I'll follow too. But first, let me go say goodbye to my family. Not bury my family, but go say goodbye. Seems normal. But Jesus responded and said, no. Anyone who puts his hand to a plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom. Harsh, seemingly. Difficult, yes. Harsh, no. The term in the Greek, let me go say goodbye to my family, is almost the same language as the other man asking, can I go bury my father? What this man is saying, can I go spend time with my family till they no longer lead me? Can I go say goodbye? Can I go spend an extended period of time? I just need to go spend time with them and then I'll come follow you. Almost the same language, but Jesus' response is different. He doesn't tell this man, birds have nests and foxes have holes. You know, like he says back, no person puts their hand to the plow, then looks back, is fit for the kingdom. The third thing that's gonna change, and this is the hardest for sure, is it's gonna cost you altered relationships. Following Jesus, friend, is gonna alter your relationships. It changes who you date. It changes who you're friends with. It changes who you rock with, who you roll with, who you live with. It changes. Well, these are people I roll with. Jesus might change that. These are my day ones. They might be your day zeros. That was funny. They might be your day negative ones. I think what most people don't want to admit if you start following Jesus, it's going to alter your relationships. And it does. And it will. Yeah, but like, I want to go home. I'm sick of Portland. I want to go back to New York, back to LA, back to Atlanta, back to Seattle, back to wherever you're from. I want to go back to Texas. I want to go back to whatever you're from, wherever state you live in. You're here because of Nike and jobs and marriage and world and whatever. And you're like, but I feel that Jesus has me here, but my family's there. My friends are there. I don't feel totally home here, but I feel like Jesus' peace is telling me to stay here. But I feel like that relationship has changed so much because I started following Jesus. Yes. Yeah. Following Jesus is going to alter your relationships. And sometimes we are more committed to our dysfunctional relationships than we are Him. No, these are my people. I'm your person. But what if they don't want to follow? You're following me. But what if we're dating and it's been like 6 years and I want to start following Jesus and they don't? Who are you more committed to? This is just very real. Yeah. I can like move back home and make more money and be outside of God's will. Be rich and unhappy. Or you can stay and be in the middle of God's will, full of peace, but your sister's not close. Or your dad doesn't live next door. Or your best friend's moved. This is very real, friends. And that's why like this sermon is so hard for people, because for two things. Number one, a lot of people in this room all day today are starting, I'm giving you words to what you've experienced. You're like, this is what's happened. It's cost me. Yeah. Yeah, it has. Because this is the thing. And I would submit. I think with what it's cost you actually gives you weight to your witness. So these friends, like, oh, you're cute. Go to church. That's cute. Oh, it's not cute. I don't think you have any idea what this cost me. Well, yeah, religion and ideals of God and no. This isn't some game. This isn't some cute fantasy I play in my mind of who Jesus is. This isn't some like cult-like religion thing. I just go to church on Sundays and mark my box. Like, I don't think you understand what it's cost me to say yes to this. And then you start conveying and relaying what it's cost you. And then they're like, and he's still worth it. That's what it cost you to say yes. And you're still that committed? Mm-hmm. Well, now I'm interested because he must be really good. He is. It's worth it? Yeah, and you lost what? Everything. But what I gained is more than what I lost. What did you gain? Him. Yeah, but what else? Bigger home, bigger wallets? No, I'm actually poorer than I've ever been. Because he makes me give my money to everyone. Actually, like, had to give that house away because he told me to because I loved it too much. Yeah, what about that business? I had to sell it. I loved money a lot. Dude, it sounds like he made you do a lot. But I have him. He doesn't seem worth it. Oh, in the beginning it doesn't. You seem like you lost a lot, but once you keep following and don't quit, you realize really quick that he's more than what you lost. And this is why I think many people can leave church so quick. Like out of one weekend, they're gone. It's because it cost them nothing to come. So it cost them nothing to leave. That's why I think people all around this world and in this city are leaving Jesus like nothing. So quickly, just, I'm out. You're there for 3 years. Yeah, we're out. How is it that easy? Oh, it cost me nothing to start. So it cost me nothing to leave. Maybe I'll be the honest preacher in your life. Not the most encouraging today, I apologize. But this is the fact. It's a fact. It's going to cost you some stuff. And if you're in this room today, overflow in nursing mom's room, and you're like, I've been following for some time and it's cost me nothing, but I don't think you fully said yes yet. because it's going to cost you some stuff. There's some areas of your life that you keep saying no in. It's going to cost you. And now some of you are like, I don't know if I want this. Good. Consider if this is worth it to you. Like you came with your girlfriend today. You're like, I don't know if church is for me. Good. Consider if this is it for you. This is worth it for you. I love people that sign up for baptism class and they do the class and they process what it's going to mean and they go, I don't want to get baptized. I'm not ready for that yet. Good. Count the cost. Mean it. Mean something to you. Don't just do it because your girlfriend wants to do it, your spouse wants to do it, it seems fun. Like, understand what you're doing. And I appreciate people and respect people so much when they're like, I'm not ready. I don't want to do that yet. Because what are they realizing? It's going to cost me a lot, isn't it? Yep. It is. What's it going to cost me? I feel like God let you down. Broken expectations. Okay, what else? He's going to change your whole life. You, I have plans. Not anymore. I have a 10-year thing. I will get done. Probably not. People with these friends and these relationships and this, he's going to change it all. He will alter every relationship you have. In John 6, when Jesus preaches this sermon and the whole crowd, the Bible says, and disciples, not the crowd, and disciples say, we're leaving. They all leave, and then Jesus looks at Peter, James, and John. He goes, you guys going to leave too? And they go, where would we go? And they say, we've left homes. We've left family. We've left jobs. They list all the things they've left. And they go, where can we go? For you have the words of life. Hear me. If you have somewhere else to go, you'll probably go. If you have somewhere else to go, you'll probably go. But you're like, Jesus is it. I have nowhere else to go. I've left everything. Jesus, this teaching's super hard, but like I have nowhere to go, so I'm in. Why? And I'll end where I started in this super, super encouraging sermon today. Are we becoming modern Christians or ancient disciples? You know why? Because modern Christianity is a lie. There's lies to it. And the lie is you can follow Jesus and lose nothing. It's a lie. You can follow Jesus and your life will not change at all. That's a lie. You will follow Jesus and just add him to your life and everything will keep going. It's a lie. We're not called to become this modern Christian spiritual enthusiast churchgoer. We're called to become ancient disciples that actually follow Jesus. And maybe I'm the first person to tell you, it's going to cost you. And I know some people in this room that have laid down much. And if I had a mic, they'd get on the stage and they'd all tell you how much it cost them, comma, how much it was worth it. I know people in this room who've laid down. That's why, like, I think some of the best Christians, I don't know if I should say this. I'll say it. I think some of the best Christians there are people that left other faiths like Hindu and Buddhist because it cost them everything to choose him. Go ask a Hindu what happened when they left. They lost everything. They didn't lose a friend on TikTok. They lost family dinners. They lost their name in the will. They lost siblings. But they'll tell you, Jesus was worth it all. Ask Stacy, wherever she is. She's at last service. I don't know where she is, if she's here today. But my amazing friend Stacy, who was raised Jewish, like for real Jewish her entire life, started coming to church here, started watching The Chosen, and gave her life to Jesus during an episode of The Chosen. Was like, oh no, you're the Messiah. So one Sunday she comes up to me, right here, weeping. I was like, can you pray for me? I was like, for what? She's from New York. Should I have to fly home and tell my Jewish family Jesus is the Messiah? And I was like, woo! She's like, I don't think you get it. Like, I can lose my name in every will. I will never be invited back to any birthday. Like, I'm flying home to tell my parents Jesus is the Messiah. And she's realizing, this is going to cost me. She flies home and comes back and then meets me afterwards. I was like, it was the best. But what? I think some of the greatest Christians on this earth are people that actually had to leave something. And it actually cost them people. I think the Christians that are getting nothing done for the kingdom tried to get in through the half-off section. It changed none of their life with following Jesus. That's why they do nothing for the kingdom, because it cost them nothing to get in. I told you, friends, this preaching does not build churches. It shrinks them, but it does build disciples. It does build people fully committed to following Jesus. And that's what we are interested in, at this church, at least. It's going to cost you.